tax off, and that's your job. And you wanted to wait today to wear his new suit. So he got to church, and he promised me he took the tax off. And he raised his arm, praising the Lord, and had one tag under here. And he went to go like this, and he was stitched up.
Oh, boy.
So I'm speaking for Bob Toronto. Howdy, he is so proud to be here.
I There's gold. not that I, the Lord thy God, cannot do these very things you have asked of me. Think not that my power is not able to lift you up and breathe into your nostrils a new life and to straighten your staggering steps.
Yes, yes. Amen.
And to give you a sure, brisk pace as you walk in the ways of thy God. I am able to clear up the clouds of confusion. I am able to cause the sky to become clear again, that the light of my word might shine within your hearts and give you an understanding of the things that I am doing in this day. Think not it's been just for someone else, but I am ready to open up the doors that have been closed. I'm ready to do those things that I've only spoken to you in metaphors and in types. Let doubt be gone from your hearts and believe on me with all of your heart. Trust the Lord your God. Throw yourselves on the rock. Submit yourselves to the workings of this day. And I will not fail you to bring you forth, to resurrect you, to give you reason for living. For life is about to erupt up out of your bellies. And my kingdom is about to be established within the hearts of a people. Those that have wavered and those that have seemingly scattered abroad, I will bring back unto this day. Many that have left you will return with joy on their heads. Many that you thought you would never see again, I am going to bring them up out of their caves, up out of their hiding places. I'm going to bring them up out of the valley of indecision and despair. And I'm going to bring back unto you those that you thought were going to go to death, never fulfilling that I placed within their hearts. I'm going to bring the healing into my body. For there has been a valley of dry bones whose flesh have been plucked from them. And they have laid bleaching within the trials of this day. And you are going to rise up. And you are going to prophesy under the four winds of the Spirit of the Lord. And you are going to cry unto this people, thou hast said our hope is lost, and we shall not rise again. We are cut off from all of our parts. And you will say to them that the Lord has come this day to breathe life unto you and to bring bone to bone, part to part, joint to joint. And he's going to put flesh and sinew upon you. And he's going to breathe into your nostrils the pneuma of life. And that which once was dead is going to live again. nation that was not a nation. And every man is going to stand in his place in this day of the Lord. And every man is going to stand shoulder to shoulder, a great army of God. And I am going to make Israel whole again. Rise up in my strength. Rise up in my power. Fear not the faces of men. Let your forehead be strong against their forehead. Be thou not rebellious as the other house was. Eat that that I put within your hand to eat. Consume it all. Leave nothing remaining. Eat all that I have given unto you this day. And I will send you forth with power from on high. Your words will change the course of men's lives. And rivers will run up the mount. The desert will blossom as a rose. Zion will rejoice with singing and rejoicing and dancing. For the King is in her of a truth. I am coming to your rescue, to cut from off of you the foreskin of another day. And I am going to cause you to be free from the weights that have so easily beset you in days gone by. You're going to lose your lust of this life. And you're going to lose your life that you might gain it. Seek the Lord and you will find him. Seek his face and you'll not be disappointed. Cry aloud and spare not. Lift up your voices in this day. Cause your words to become the words of him that liveth forevermore. Fear not to create a new world in your midst. I'm going to bring unto you the fatherless and the widows, the homeless and the prisoners, and you're going to be able to set them free by the power of my word. Count it not a small thing when I bring unto you the undone and the lost and them that have no reason to live. You're going to give them that reason to live. You're going to cut off from them the former house of flesh and set them free from a genealogy of pain and destruction. And you're going to graft them in to an everlasting branch, the root of David, the everlasting vine, in whom all that dwell will live and not die. Take my body. Eat of it, drink my blood, have communion in me this day, that you may no longer sleep and be sick and weakly, but that thou might rise up in the strength of thy God and march throughout this land, deliverers and saviors unto me. I'm not going to move like I have in days gone by. So don't hold me to the day that you've been in. The mode of operation is changing.
Yes.
Along with the new order, I'm going to give you a new way to minister that order. It's never been seen in the earth. There's going to be one voice and one sound. I'm going to unite your motive and your purpose so that you can see and behold the wonder of my word as it's accomplished within your midst. If you try to save any by protecting them from the fire of the Lord, I say unto thee, thou shalt surely lose them. But if you will allow my word to be spoken in your midst without fear, I will change the minds of them in your midst and appear to them with the same light that I appeared to you. Why hold back the blessings of God? Won't you allow my word to come forth in clarity, fearing no man, but ministering this day as it is, without any mixture of the old, but a pure, undefiled word that will go into the heart of man and cut asunder the soul from the spirit. And it will reveal the very intents of their hearts. Run into the day that I have called thee unto. For in the fire of that day is your salvation. As I make you that fire, and as you set men's fields on fire, you will rejoice and lift your hands and glorify me in the fire. Fear not and worry not. Just do what I say to do. Speak what I say to speak, and you'll see the salvation of God in your midst. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Praise.
Glory to God. I'm just going to say a little bit, and then I'm going to let my wife come. Hallelujah. I really feel that song that we sung, that Fred and them sang, struck me so much. That song, Do You Really Know? Or Are You Really Willing? Do you really see ahead the road that God's bringing us down? Do we really know what this day is going to ask of us?
Amen.
As it's revealed in our midst. And I was thinking today, you know, God's a lot more serious about this day than you and I are. He's a lot more serious about getting this thing done than a lot of times you and I are. Because he's been involved in it since the beginning. It's his creation. And I sincerely believe that this day, without trying to sound too extraordinary, I sincerely believe that everything that has gone on in God from Adam on up here is hinging on what we do with this day of the Lord. I think it all is hinging on how we allow God to move in our midst. Hallelujah. And we are saying over at Brother Dale's meeting, and I want to say it again, in days gone by, people got to moving in a movement many times because of the blessings in it. Because what can I get out of this movement? The miracle, especially the tent revivals and all of the demonstration of the blessings of God. You know and I I know, because most of us was in that, some of us at least were, you know, and I know that a lot of the reasons, the only reason why anybody was there was because they wanted to get healed, or they wanted to, had to have something done for them. God wanted to see God perform a miracle in their midst. And many believed on God because of those miracles, but many still just remain the same anyhow. I don't see this day moving as that day did. If I understand the scriptures right, this is a narrow way that few find. It's not a majority way right now. It's a narrow, untrodden way without a beaten path through it. You have to have a certain skill to be able, like a woodsman, to be able to follow a trail that seemingly isn't there. Hallelujah. And I sincerely believe that we're moving out of one ship into another ship. Meaning from sonship, possibly into another ship. And I don't know what to call it. But we're moving from one area of service unto God into another area. I want us to get ready for this. I pray that what we have felt, and Gene, I saw the same thing. I sense something has begun. And I sense that something has ended. And I see with other eyes. You know, when Daniel went into the lion's den and God kept him from getting ate alive, I've often wondered, well, was that because God changed the lions, or did God change Daniel? Which one was changed? Did the lions not eat him because God took away their desire for flesh? Or did the lions not attack Daniel because they felt no fear of man, which is a natural enemy to an animal? You don't have to do or say anything to them. It's the smell. They smell the man, and they attack that smell. I know I'm the favorite dog food in the United States. If they could market me, Apple would go out of business. There's something about me and dogs that I must be sweeter than honey to them. I don't know. But they all want to take a little bite. Hallelujah. But they're evidently, you smell when you don't think you do. Evidently, those canines can smell things that wasn't quite so appealing to anyone else around here. But you know, there are two glands in us. Amen? The two types of glandular activity in us in survival is fight or flight. That's what our body reacts on survival for. God put it there to keep you alive from all the dinosaurs. Hallelujah. He gave you the ability to either fight superhumanly or run superhumanly. Hallelujah. They call them the fight and flight glands. But either one of them does something to the inner parts of you somehow or another. There's a chemical reaction when that happens. I'll never forget when I was, I had this old trader guy that moved traders. A shark, I was trying to get a trader moved there in Dixon, and I had gone to a shop to let him know what time to come get the trader. And he has a junkyard in the back, and then he has his big garage there. And so I goes to the shop. I knew I was going to get, you know, it was close to time for him to close. So I got there, pulled up. I said, oh, I'm late, maybe still here. And I went to the front door off of Main Street there and jerked it open. It stuck a little bit, and I jerked it open and slammed it shut behind me. I said, "Harry! Hey, Harry!" He went and asked me, so the garage was all the way open from the front door to the back of the junkyard there. So I just starts walking through that garage. All of a sudden, I realized no lights are on. Harry's gone. Harry ain't even there. And I said, "Well, Harry's not even here." And then I looked, and he had an old pickup truck out there, and out of that pickup bed, three German Shepherd junkyard dogs' heads. I said, "But they are." And it's just me and them. And so I measured. I'm halfway through the garage, and it's about equal distance from them to me and me to the door. And when I was young, and that flight gland erupted in me, I could outrun any dog on the block. I guess I put on a little weight. Because I measured it out, and I said, "Well, like the scripture says, if we stay here, we die." So we run. And I said, "I can make it. I know I can." And you know, normally, see, I have gotten a little heavier and everything than I was when I was a kid. And normally I wouldn't have made it, but that flight gland was there, sister. And it erupted in adrenaline throughout me, and I outran them dogs to that door. Trouble was, when I skidded up to the door to open it, the doorknob was gone. Oh, Harry, Harry, Harry. Why are you doing this to me? The only thing there is that little hex iron there, you know, the handle that hooks onto. And I'm going like this. And I'm not going to make it. They're coming at me right here, right to me. So so I turns around, and there's, come to find, there's two young dogs, fully grown, but they're young. And the other one was an old guy. They're around the block. He had trophies hanging over his ears. And I'm trying to get that next door open. And then and so I said, "I've got these." And so I tried to sound as much like Harry as I could. He's a gruff old guy, and I said, "Dog, lay down!" Well, I had a little bit more tremor in my voice. But they stopped, at least. And they just, you know, stiff-legged, they're going, walking around me and everything. So I've got my back to the door, and I'm trying to get that hex thing open, and it's breaking my finger. And every time I make a noise with it, they and so I'm trying to act nice, so I'm saying, "I said, go sit down, dog, won't lay down." And everybody up going, "Oh, God, oh, God, oh, God." And I got that door trying to open it up, and the two young dogs, you know, they went and laid down. So I knew I was getting somewhere, but that old dog, he said, "You don't look a bit like Harry." Walking around. I finally felt it click open. And so then all I had to do was just get out before they got me. And God, again, you know, I yelled at him a little bit more, and the dog turned his back on me, and I jerked around and shut that door. And they attacked the door and tried to tear it down to get at me, but they couldn't get at me, and so I just fell to the ground right there on the sidewalk. Right down on the sidewalk. Sweat. We hopped out on the sidewalk. And I was drenched in sweat. And I couldn't hardly walk for about 5 minutes. When I did, I walked around. Just don't let them see the sweat. And so I was dry the whole time I was facing the dog until I got out of the danger. And all of a sudden, all this sweat. sweat just drenches me, and I fall to the ground. But there's a fight and flight in us. And what God's doing is he's changing our mode of operations. We're getting ready to get on the offensive. So far, we've been on the defensive. We've been in our places. We've just been there, getting hopefully perfected by God and allowing this word to work in us and to get us ready for something. But this is why I feel it's changing. God has had a people prepared out in the world along with us. I don't think we're the only ones getting prepared by God. There's another people out here that we don't even know, I'm sure of it. To think that we're the only group that is hearing anything like this is, to me, somewhat ridiculous. God's always had people in the earth that don't know each other. They're just there. We've had people in our own backyard right there in Dixon, Tennessee, that sees some of the truths that we see. We've been there for, I guess, 12 years, or more than 12 years in Tennessee, but up in Dixon there. We've been there a long time, and they have never known of us, and we've never known of them until just recently. People in our own backyard were being worked on by God, just like we are. When the timing of God is here for us to change mode of operations, and this is what I'm feeling led with me is, you get a vision of the Lord, and we've had revelations, and we've had prophecies. All we've lacked was the means. God gives you a word, but that's not enough. As all of us preachers have learned, it's not enough just to be called a preacher. The man at the gas pump, the grocery store, don't understand that. I'm a man of God. Give me my gas and let me get out of here. Well, that don't mean too much to them. You've got to have money to pay for your gas.
Yes.
And you've got to be supported somehow. And God gives us a vision of meetings. Well, you have to have a building in order to keep the rain off the people's heads. You don't have that unless you have certain means given to you. And when you get right down to it, with all the spiritual word that God's given to us, we still need a natural means in order to bring it into motion and to see it fulfilled. That's something this movement, if we want to call it whatever we want to call it, I don't know what to call it, this age has missed and not had. Ministry have gone astarving in this word. And I'm not blaming anyone. I'm just saying that has always seemed to be a part of this day. For one thing, I don't think that God was going to let you come into this word because of the money of it. For one thing, I think it's been that way because there's nothing here naturally to draw us. The only thing that draws you to this day is the truth of it. Hallelujah. And that speaks to your inner man. I believe that God has worked over on many of us financially so that when the finances do come in, hopefully we don't go the way of other men. Hallelujah. Hopefully we don't do the same thing another generation has done and got caught up in the money game of it and done anything just to keep that money coming in. This is why Paul said, I know both how to be full and empty. Hallelujah. How to have everything and nothing at all. Hallelujah. He saw both sides of the coin, and he knew that God was there regardless of whether he had $1 million or whether he could just barely get by making tents. God let him know he was the same God, and that doesn't give you any more anointing. That doesn't give you any more life flow to have your bills paid. Yeah, hallelujah. In fact, it might even work the directly opposite. Hallelujah. But I do want to give you a word. That God is doing more than just giving us revelation. He's been dealing with the inner parts of our man. So that when the multitudes' heads start turning toward this ministry, they're at least schooled in the hard knocks of God. And they don't just operate it like a business or like a church or like a system. But they have within them the nature of their God. Hallelujah. And they don't allow the things of this world to muddy up the stream of life. Hallelujah. Now, I believe there's still a lot more to work on us in that way. fear of my own mind if God was to give me $1 million. I wouldn't really know what to do with it, and I don't know what I would turn into if God did. I don't know how many instant friends I might have. Hallelujah. You know, it's amazing what $1 million in the bank does for your relationship with people. Hallelujah. Whereas before they might give you the time of day, now you're their best buddy. Hallelujah. But I believe that we are being schooled in this day a lot more than just getting taught revelation. I think that, like Corinthians says, and this is something God has shown me a long time ago, that this corruptible must put on incorruptibility. The mortal and the must there in the King James is in italics, but literally in the original language it's not even there. The must is on the corruptibleness. The mortal being changed into immortality is automatic. Hallelujah. What goes on the inside is what you see on the outside. The earth follows the heavens. Your body's going to follow your inner man into life. It's not coming from the heavens down on you. Mortality is being swallowed up from the inside. Hallelujah. It's being put on with a garment. Hallelujah. Putting on the Lord Jesus Christ. I, for one, think we're a little bit too grave conscious. I think God wants us to get a little bit more death conscious than grave conscious. Yes. To me, the grave isn't death in the sense that the Scriptures talks about death. To me, death is a process that begins when you're born. The grave is just a changing over place, where you lay down that natural body and you go into another dimension in God. But literally, the death that you and I need to be concerned with right now is that death in us that works strife, envy, jealousy, malice, all of these things. That as long as we have operating within our temples, we cannot totally come into the fullness of expression that God wants us to. So I see a love being put in the hearts of the ministry. In fact, I see that superseding doctrine. I see that love superseding all of us coming into the same teaching. I see that impartation of Christ's love, that agape love within us, superseding me trying to get you speaking the same way that I'm speaking. Hallelujah. Because I know what the Scripture says. That love can cover a multitude of differences. Hallelujah. And of things that that in any other environment would cause a molehill to be turned into a mountain. Hallelujah. But God, through the love and the unity of the presence of this day, is causing us to find common ground. Hallelujah. And in that common ground, there's enough ground in the common right now for us to do a great work for God. Hallelujah. And as we all come under the expression of this day, I sincerely believe, is there anybody here that's ever been caught up into the presence of the Lord and not been willing to lay everything down for it? Hallelujah. Glory to God. When you're caught up into the full expression of the Christ, you're willing to do anything to please that expression. Hallelujah. And I believe with all of my heart, this is what's going to draw people to us, is the feeling of love and completeness in the midst of this people. Hallelujah. What's going to set our meetings aside from any other meeting? What's going to set this word aside from any other word, or this people from any other people? It's not going to be the words you speak from your mouth. It's going to be the atmosphere that you carry around and about you. Hallelujah. It's going to be your inward relationship with the Christ himself. Hallelujah. I believe we've missed it when we tried to just get people to know the word of this day. We need to know the nature of this day. Hallelujah. And how that day, the nature of it, is working to bring people's lives transition. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I want you to know something. I have sensed the change. The change is here. Hallelujah. And it has changed in me mightily. Hallelujah. And I'm looking forward to days to come. I'm looking forward with a heart of expectation and with a joy in my heart and a feeling of energy in me like I have never felt before, of seeing God accomplish these things that He's spoken to us in the Spirit and to give us the physical means to come into these things and do them in the name of the Lord. I'm looking for the day to come when God's going to have a ministry that's going to be sent out of a place fully equipped to bring forth the word unto all the other nations. Hallelujah. I'm just looking for that. And I'm looking for God to start raising up businessmen and businesswomen and others that have got means above and beyond their own to start supporting a word in the earth. Hallelujah. And to see these things accomplished in the natural. And that's the word the Lord spoke to me this morning. I'm not only going to give you a revelation of this day, I'm going to give you the means to accomplish it. Hallelujah. Beating our swords into plowshares, our spears into pruning hooks. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And causing these things to accomplish great, great, and mighty significant things in the hearts of the people. I'm looking for us to throw off all of our frailties and to be made whole and new in our God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But let's balance this thing out. Hallelujah. Let's be sure to create an environment that's conducive. Is that the right word for it?
Yes.
To growth.
Yes.
Hallelujah. You can't plant corn out in the desert. Hallelujah. You have to have a little water there. Not a matter of just plant seeds. After you plant it, you better take care of it.
That's right.
Now you and I know both that there's been ministry in the land that have done nothing more than just plant the seed and then go off.
Right.
Like some sailor in a port. Amen. Doing their thing in God.
Amen.
And then you never see them again.
Mm-hmm.
They can care less how you're doing or what you're doing afterwards. They're just there to preach. And that's why God's not going to, you see, that's what I'm saying. It's not a matter of just coming into a word. It's a matter of, why are you preaching?
Come around every 6 months and get the tithes.
That type of a thing. And I believe with all of my heart, like Brother Sister McGee and Dale and Ruth and the rest of Brother Fred and all these men and women, I have, Brother Sister Pratt, I have every faith to believe that God's got them in a righteous attitude. And it's a shame that we have gone without so far. But praise the Lord. Hallelujah. In my heart, I feel this morning things are going to change in this way. Hallelujah. But there's also a dread in there that we not misuse it. And that we don't let it go the way to where we start causing just those that we like to get blessed in that way. I remember when Dale came into Phoenix, we didn't know the man. And none of us knew what to think of this guy. Which is natural in that way. You've got all these people there. We've never just set somebody loose on them that we didn't know anything about. God spoke to us and said, this man's got a word for this people.
4 hours.
You timed it, didn't you? And nobody walked out that I know of. I don't think anybody walked out.
And there's 9 o'clock people.
That's right. But you see, this is where we need the supernatural to come into our midst. Hallelujah. And I want to make a way for that supernatural to appear.
Amen.
That's why we're starting to say more and more, don't you come in here looking for just another church service. No telling what'll happen today. No telling what God will do by the end of all of this. Hallelujah. So get your heart ready, friend.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Get prepared for these things. Yeah. Reno and the other groups, get prepared for these things. Hallelujah. Let's offer everything we have unto the Lord for this day. It's the little things that'll kill us. It's the little things that'll show up at the end. Let's get rid of those little things. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I don't know if this is a day of gaining or removing. Hallelujah. Maybe it's both. But I thank God, along with giving us things, He's removing things out of us. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We bless you. I bless you in the name of Jesus. I bless you. I ask my God to deliver you unto this day. I ask my God to cause your spirit, hallelujah, to be quickened in the day of the Lord. And to not doubt one word that God is speaking to us. Hallelujah. Pray that God opens up your eyes and receive the heavenly host. And all that's gone before this day, groaning, prevailing, encouraging. You and I to take a step, hallelujah, forward in the day of the Lord. Get ready, you're going on the offensive. Hallelujah. You're going to conquer, to pull down, to destroy, and to plant and to build. Hallelujah. Praise God. We're going to establish places around this country. We're going to bring a people that's scattered and just wandering out here like lost sheep without a shepherd. God's going to start bringing forth people, and they're going to start shepherding a flock. Hallelujah. And they're not going to count it a small thing to stay at home and to feed the people instead of going off into the wild blue yonder just to get another word. I believe that with all of my heart. Hallelujah. That God's going to start establishing certain centers all around the country where God's people can start flowing into and encouraging one another. And we're going to start seeing a real lifeline set up. Hallelujah. Where if there's needs, you're not going to be all by yourself. Others are going to join in. Just by ourselves, we can't do very much. But you get all of us together, and there's not too much that we can't do. Hallelujah. As we start joining forces for a common cause. I feel that down to my toes. There's a ministry joining forces with one another. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Do you feel the strength of this? Hallelujah, praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's just like when you wed somebody, man. Everybody thinks being single so great. Hallelujah. Well, it's got its great points. But they're just little points. Just like there's a glory to the trusted.
Yes.
Certain glory to being seen. But you're never really going to be fulfilled. Truthfully, there's no feeling like becoming a father. And to be put responsible for something in your life. Hallelujah. There's no feeling like it. All of a sudden has something placed in your midst. You're going to care for it, nurture it, and you have the opportunity to bring it up in the way that you see fit today to be brought up in. Hallelujah. It's a different aspect. It's a different glory. And I guess that's what I'm saying. The glory of this latter house, regardless of what we really, we can't imagine it too much because we've seen a lot of glory in this realm. The glory of this next order is going to supersede the glory of all orders. Glory to God. A people's going to start coming together, not just to be blessed, create an atmosphere in the heavens that's conducive to growing. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Tell them at home sometimes that, for a while anyway, that we're all in our places with bright, shiny faces and nobody knows what to do. But I feel like in this hour that we're getting in our places with bright, shiny faces and Father is letting us know what to do. And this is making a great difference. It's making a difference for us. It's making a difference for assemblies. It's doing something that, and I know everybody's tired today. I'm just going to take a couple of minutes, but I feel to share what's on, what Father gave me to this morning. I want to say that I think we've gotten to a place in our consciousness that we limit God, not only his benefits, but sometimes we gather in amongst one another and we can't, we're always in a rush. This society's in a rush. We're in a rush to go somewhere, a rush to get somewhere. And I've gotten to the place of late, Gene, that I feel this way. If God wants to speak to us, I think back in days of old, if he wanted to speak to somebody, they sat for no matter how long it took till God got said what he wanted to say. And if anybody's in a rush or too tired today, we excuse you, but I believe that God's called a holy convocation.
Yes.
And he's dealing with us and he's instructing us and he's telling us some things. And if you get tired of the chariot, I'll sit down on the floor. Take your shoes off. Do whatever. I was thinking when Paul was saying about the great gulf. There was 9 years ago in that meeting. There was a great gulf. God was intervening and plucking some out. Some that he had chosen. Some that he had let go certain ways. That he might bring them again unto Zion. That he might plant within them the purity of their God. A chosen seed, a righteous seed. And I remember, and I know Paul remembers well, I had ministered, and this one brother, he was very upset with me. He was the leader of the gulf. He didn't like my blue eyes. And so he got down on his knees in front of me in the whole assembly after I sat down, and he said, "Bless God, I don't believe a word you said." And he read me out. Right there, and I said, "Praise God." But the whole time he was doing that, there was a song going through my head, and I was singing, "Lo, I looked and I beheld the heavens open up, and I heard a voice, the righteous one appeared." That's all I could think about while he was doing that. And the funniest thing was, there was a little brother that never says anything. He's so quiet, you don't know if he'd ever said. He was taping. His wife says plenty, but he never says anything. And all at once I looked over there, and here he is, he's rolling up his sleeves. I thought, what's he doing? You know, I just glanced over there. And pretty soon I saw his wife take him and set him down. And boy, all this was going on. The great gulf was happening. And all at once Robert said, she said, "Where are you going?" He said, "I'm going over there and whip that feller for talking to her like that." Never says anything in a meeting, never utters a sound, never does anything. But somebody challenged something that he evidently believed in. He was rolling up his sleeves. So I thank God today that our Father is in control.
Yes.
He's out after us. There was a thought that came to me this morning. I think Bob probably touched on about every bit of it by the Spirit. But in Luke, the 22nd chapter, I'm assured today that we're a part of a plan, friend. I'm assured of that. Our God has definite plan in mind. I know that. I kind of feel as the end of the year is going out, if I might say this, that We as a body here, we've gathered for the Last Supper. Is that all right? Before the marriage. Jesus had a desire to eat the Passover with his disciples before he suffered, that he might go into another place. And I woke up this morning and it was as if God was saying in my spirit, I've gathered the chosen together, I've put them in the place here today, and I am going to deal with my disciples. I am going to give my disciples at least a word of instruction and encouragement to say, take the Last Supper, bear about the sufferings as Jesus did, but get ready for a great ascension. He gave a great instruction, and I'm going to start at 25th verse. And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors. But ye shall not be so. Be he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger, and he that is chief as he that doth serve. We're going to start a new year tomorrow. Many of us are being turned in many directions. Bob was saying about centers everywhere. The Lord woke me up a few months ago in the middle of the night and said, I'm going to set restoration centers out across the country. And I don't know his plan in doing all this. And I'm not trying to set anybody in one. I'm just trying to be available to function wherever God puts me. As soon as we told God we would be available, he took us at our word. And we not only have to oversee Tennessee now, we have another church building and don't know what we're doing in Texas. But it was placed in our hands, and we're doing to the best of our ability to yield to whatever God wants in this hour, to be servant to all, to be that God is requiring out of us to be. I'm sure of this, that there is a qualification that must come forth for the sound that is to be presented. And if anybody hasn't yet acquired the sound of the corporate expression, get ready. This year is ending and the new year is beginning. And I decree and I declare to you that we're going to unify ourselves into the heavens with a trump that will sound a sound that will be heard, and there will be no distinction of flesh out of it, but our Lord God will reign in amongst us, and I'm declaring that today.
Praise God.
For whether it's greater, he that sitteth at meat, or he that serveth, is not he that sitteth at meat, but I am among you as he that serveth. Ye are they which have continued with me in my temptations. Beloved, I see also what Jean and Bob see, and I have an humble feeling in my spirit this morning as I look and behold you and realize that you are those who have continued with him in his temptations and in the places that he's put you and in the sufferings. And I know that he's appointed unto you a time to possess the kingdom. I know that he has a preparation right at the door. I want to be a part of that and behold that and rejoice with what our God is doing. And I appoint unto you a kingdom as my Father has appointed unto me, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on my thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. I want to say something that the table, a song that Gene mentioned the other day, this feast is at hand, beloved. It won't rain upon our land if we don't sit at this table. It's just that plain. I'm being honest with you. It's not going, it'll rain the latter. That's still going on in a measure. But the latter and the former coming together, we're going to have to sit at the table of the Lord. Now that word table there meant a couple of things. It do is going to be paid.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
That you've asked for, you're going to get. And God's going to begin to deal with you. What are you going to do with this? How are you going to judge the 12 tribes of Israel? In times past, many without the qualifying and the training would have judged as the word meant in condemnation. And many desired to punish. What they felt the punishment should be. Do you know what I'm saying? That word judging means to conclude. It means damn. It also means desire. And it means determine. And there's going to be two ways in this beginning of the year that we can decide how we're going to sit at the table. It means to esteem, judge does. And it means to ordain. And I tell you this morning, I so choose to esteem you already going into the perfection place and age of our God. And if I stand in your midst as anything at all today, it will be to ordain you a holy priesthood, righteous before your God, hallelujah, setting you free to stand up in this hour to bring the words of the living God.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen, Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen, Lord.
Well, if I don't punish some, they'll get by, honey. No flesh is going to enter in. Our God is well able to handle everything that we commit unto Him, Brother Johnson.
Amen.
So we've got some decisions to make. We sit at the table, you're sitting at the bank.
Amen.
That word means that. You know why we haven't been? We have not yet learned how to deal out righteously unto all mankind. But I see a day, and I hear a voice, and I see some footsteps going out in before a path that's been laid before us. And it's going to bring some joy. Several years ago, I was telling Paul, I don't know how many, Paul, probably 8, 9 years ago. I said, I was in a state, and I said, Paul, I don't know if I'll ever laugh again. He just kind of silently grinned at me, started laughing. And you know what's happened? One day God spoke to me and said, I'm going to make you blithe. I thought that meant skinny. I said, God don't need that. It meant cheerful. You know what? I started laughing. I laugh all the time.
Praise God.
And I can't quit laughing, gee. Come hell or hot water, I laugh.
Yes.
Wonderful. Great. Yes.
I count it a privilege to sit at His table. I don't want to miss it. I got drunk in the Spirit one night in Tennessee, and I won't tell you too much about that. It's pretty bad. But I was declaring to them that if I was too drunk to sit at the table, I had some friends in the assembly who would pick me up, bless God, and set me on my seat.
Yes.
I do. And I'll tell you something. If you want to kind of come unglued today and get out of your natural thinking and carnality, just get in the Spirit and let a little new wine flow on you. If you fall off your seat and the table is spread before us, I'll pick you back up and set you back in your seat.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
All right, now, Lord.
Can you hear me spiritually?
Yes.
Yes. Hey.
New wine.
I haven't got down where I want yet, but I'm going. Let's go down to 36. Praise God. And He said unto them, but now, well, first I want to go, no, I want to back up, 35. And He said unto them, when I sent you, He was talking to His disciples. God really spoke this to my heart. He's talking to us. When I sent you without person, script, and shoes, lacked you anything? And they said nothing. And beloved, in the day that we've walked in, that has been the truth. I can can testify to it. Every time he sent us, every time he's told us, it makes no difference. God did meet the need in that day, and we lacked nothing. We lacked nothing. Everything got paid eventually. Hallelujah. I never went without clothes to wear. I told somebody yesterday, I said, I don't get to pick out most of my clothes. Most of the things y'all see me in, there's two sisters that's in the body that for years have just dressed me. They don't ask me what I like. They just go get it, and they say, this is what you're going to wear. And I say, okay. And I told one sister yesterday, I said, but once in a while, I get my hands on what I want, and I go get what I want. By the way, you looked beautiful yesterday. So we've never lacked anything, but not only in the material things. I want to go beyond that.
Yes, amen.
I'm just talking naturally. I want to get in the spirit. When he sent us out without even all the goods, without all the things that we needed, we still never lacked anything.
Hallelujah.
Our God still performs. He placed within us at least enough to kindle a fire, to get something going.
Yes.
Hallelujah. We're being challenged. I believe our God is giving us some instructions and challenging us. He's going to change our vocabulary. He's going to change your ideas about your brother. He's going to, when you begin to speak out something negative, I believe he's going to clip you on the tongue, pinch you on the butt, or do something.
Amen.
Well, help me, God, I'm me. For I say unto you, nope, I missed one. Then he said unto them, but now, he that hath a purse, let him take it, and likewise his scrip. And he that hath no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. And we're being confronted with something. We've had individual garments. We've had individual coverings. And we have not seen the fullness of these lands being totally purged, but in a measure, God has done a beautiful thing in our midst, and he's going to finish that. We're going to have to sell our individual garment, if you please, and buy the sword. Sword is the word of God, and it's quick, and it's powerful, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit. We've waited for the day when a company, a corporate house raised up with the sword of this thing. Hallelujah. It is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. It'll go beyond our head knowledge. It'll go beyond our past experiences. It'll go beyond our testifying. We become the testimony, the living prophecy, the witness of Jesus Christ. And that goes into the intents of the heart. It goes beyond everything else. Oh, Hatabahaya. I tell you what, I feel a covering beginning to come over a house that has never covered a whole house before. And little individual tents coming down, little garments going, and it's time to sell those garments and buy the sword. Buy the double-edged, two-edged sword.
Amen.
I don't have much use, and I tell them this in Tennessee. I might as well say it here. We've got a beautiful people and a lot of good ministry. I haven't got much use for ministry that wants the sword to go out there and not have a double-edged one coming right back here. That's what we've got to see.
Yes.
We've been willing to deliver a word and say, oh, thou shalt. I'll tell you what, our vocabulary is changing. We shall.
Yes,
yes. We shall overcome. That this that is written must yet be accomplished. He was reckoned among the transgressors, for the things concerning me have an end. And they said, Lord, behold, here are two swords. And he said unto them, it is enough. And I say unto us today, the two-edged sword, it is enough. It is that that's going to penetrate the day. It is that that's going to cause the sound of the trump. It is that that's going to cause sitting on a throne means power. There's that power again that's going to come in the midst of his house when you gather around the table and when the meat becomes him, when we are able to accomplish in him and finish that he's given unto us to do. Hallelujah. I want to go over to Ezekiel for a minute. Well, I want to go to Amos for a minute, the 9th chapter. Eighth verse said, behold, the eyes of the Lord are upon the sinful kingdom, and I will destroy it from off the face of the earth, saving that I will not utterly destroy the house of Jacob, saith the Lord. Aren't you glad for his coming to our land? Hallelujah. For lo, I will command, and I will sift the house of Israel among all nations, like as corn is sifted in a sieve, yet shall not the least grain fall upon the earth. All the sinners of my people shall die by the sword, which say that evil shall not overtake nor prevent us. And that day will I raise up the tabernacle of David that is fallen, close up the breaches thereof, and I will raise up his ruins, and I will build it as in the days of old. Amen. That they may possess the remnant of Edom and all the heathen, which are called by my name, saith the Lord that doeth this. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that the plowman shall overtake the reaper, and the treader of grapes him that soweth seed. And the mountains shall drop sweet with wine, and all the hills shall melt. And I will bring again the captivity of my people of Israel, and they shall build the waste cities and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and drink the wine thereof, and they shall also make gardens and eat the fruit of them. And I will plant them upon their land, and they shall no more be pulled up out of their land which I have given them, saith the Lord thy God. And I'm going just quickly over to Ezekiel. He was bringing restoration to Israel. Beloved, he's bringing restoration to spiritual Israel. We're not reviving the old ways. We want him to restore us into our rightful positions. Oh, there's a lot of good word there. But I just want to go to 15, 16, the word of the Lord came again unto me, saying, moreover, thou son of man, take thee one stick and write upon it for Judah, for the children of Israel, his companions. Then take another stick and write upon it for Joseph, the stick of Ephraim, and for all the house of Israel, his companions. Join them one to another into one stick, and they shall become one in my hand. Hallelujah. I will make them one nation to the land upon the mountains of Israel, and one king shall be king to them, and they shall be no more two nations, neither shall they be divided. Into two kingdoms anymore at all. Haha, Shetaba. There is power, wonderful in the love.
Wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
I feel a bloodline that goes beyond any of our bloodlines.
Oh, yes.
That was shed for us is bringing life. Without death, I believe we're going to be able to gather one of these days, Brother McGee, without being tired and worn out from battling. You know, I tell you the truth, I was in Pittsburgh, I said to a brother, he says, you did good battle. I said, I battled the beast at Ephesus. He says, you know what that is? That's flesh. I said, what do you think we're saying? We wrestle it.
Yes.
And I am going to make a New Year's resolution. I esteem this house above all, that you might come forth, that you might penetrate old covenants, that you might tear down the flesh realm, that you might bring forth a people with joyful heart, gladness, even as they suffer, even as you sit at the last table of your existence and begin to prepare for the wedding that's ahead. Even as Revelation the 19th chapter speaks of the bride who would put on her wedding garment, so shall ye prepare yourself and make yourself ready, that ye might be a whole man standing in the earth, undivided, without your spirit being removed, that your body may conform to the words of the Spirit of life within thee. And because thou dost conform, thou shalt have a word that shall go to a nation and make them join to the stick that the Lord thy God has placed within the midst of thee. For this staff, this tree, shall be a tree for healing of the nations, and upon it shall be all the fruits of righteousness, all the healings to the nation. And thou shalt arise in the new year, and look not back from whence thou hast come, but gather in about thee all that has been placed within thee, and use it for the glory of thy God. For I'm calling thee anew. Thou shalt learn new government in the midst of thy assemblies and thy conventions, and thou shalt let a people live and flow in the river of life. And as thou shalt qualify, I shall stand thee on thy feet and say unto thee that the two-edged sword has done well in thy midst. It has gone to set free creation. It has set thee free also.
Glory, glory.
Oh, I feel a great table in our midst. The wine is the new wine. And to this point, I tell you the truth, beloved, none of us could hold it. We've had holes in our pot. We've bought that wouldn't stay. But I see another field and a pearl and a great crop. And I see that I'm willing, Ruth, to lay my life down for. Amen. Hallelujah. I've got a lot rolling in me. A lot of scripture and a lot of things going on inside of me right now, Jesus. But I only want to say, what's thus saith the Lord. I want to learn, Barry, that when he says it, say it. When he doesn't, forget it until another time. I want to learn that when he raises up, that it would be with a flow of life and understanding and truth and righteousness that will bring restoration into your house, that will restore you back to your rightful place and put you in the garden of peace wherein you'll laugh again and cry no more and rejoice for the things that thy God has done within you. For it's only been a passing fancy. It's only been a delusion and it's been a lie. But God is coming with the truth and the righteousness. And all the cycles.
the land, it will be a strong enough staff that will tear down everything that does want to destroy, and nothing will stand but he who liveth forever.
Hallelujah.
We'll be glad to say, blessed is he who cometh in the name of the Lord.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Well, I'm going to quit. It's not quitting in me. It's just quitting.
Oh.
Hallelujah. Be of good cheer. It is I. God, we say to you this day, rejoice. Son, again, I say rejoice. By making thee, I continually make thee. I'll cause thee to have favor where thee did not have. I'll cause thee to be able to lift out your hand as a helping hand and walk another mile and look not to the flesh, but look to thy God. For I've chosen thee, and this day I'm placing upon you a commission. I command you in the name of the Lord to rise up in a new place. Take no thought of the generation about thee or the peer pressure that does approach thee. For the Lord has kept thee, chosen thee unto himself, and thou shalt be a strong man, a mighty man of valor when I'm finished with thee. Look for the new year to open up new things unto thee. And when the young generation's going on by one way, you go my way, and I'll honor thee, and thy days shall be long to proclaim my word in the land. Given some jobs, we've had some put in our hands that maybe we haven't always done just the best with. But I tell you what, God's cleansing all the old and the old age from off of around us, and I declare to you today to begin something anew, to stand on your feet and take hold of the day and begin to bring forth the truth in the midst of his house, and hold back not. And do not your own thing. Let not your carnality hold you to the realms, earthly realm. But arise and ascend into the place. When he had to have his last supper, he knew he was going to suffer and die and go on into another place. That's the ministry you're going to have to minister out of. No longer a covering when he said, sell that garment. No longer that when they walked with him and they had the goods they thought, but they needed him. And he couldn't walk in their midst. He had to go where he is. And beloved, we're going to have to be where he is. Hallelujah. Could we stand? Okay. I don't know who's coming or what. I'm just here. But I want us to join hands.
Praise God. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Here I am. As the old goes out, the old year, and the new comes in, I'm asking the Lord to let me in the Spirit, though I'm on one coast and you're on another, to be aware of your need. And I want to stand with you.
Praise God.
And I'm asking you, if you would, if God brings us before you, that you would stand with us. I used to go a lot, and everywhere we've been lately, I don't care where it's been, somebody has raised up. Get ready to go more. And beloved, we can't go more without you. To tell you the truth, I don't want to. I want the full house of Israel.
Yes.
As you're raising up in your place, I want to go with you. I want to stand with you. And I want to be a part. If I don't please you all the time, bear with me. I'm lacking now. Bear with me. If you see your brother in error, go to them. speak privately with them and bring forth a word of encouragement to set them aright. Learn the ways and instructions of your God. And as we join hands today, I'm asking God to impart within us, Lord Jesus, impart within us the capability, the wisdom, and the knowledge, and the love, that this house may set every groaning creation free. And as I start off on this end, I want it to go through the congregation, squeeze the hand down the line, as we activate one another into life, where that death no more hath dominion over us. And as we stand together, becoming one, beloved, I believe in the name of the Lord, our God will perform his work. Let sickness depart off of the face of these earth. Let depression and oppression leave. Prophetic word over him, Dale.
Therefore, your joy will have no pain. For he's created and formed within you an everlasting joy. Thou might know strength beyond thine own ability. Thou might walk in the heights and in the depths of his love.
Yes.
Rejoice, therefore, in the strength the Lord shall provide, for thy every need shall be met. And he shall send thee forth in the power and in the demonstration of his Holy Spirit. And the words of thy mouth shall not be thine own, but the Lord thy God shall form them and create them and make them fruitful. For in thou shalt not be denied thy inheritance, for great shall be the Lord, and in the midst of thee. For he shall bring thee forth unto himself, and raise thee forth up into his sight, that his glory might prevail in thine earth. And thine earth shall be filled with that glory, and the presence of the Lord and the reality of his life shall be made known unto all men everywhere. Therefore humble thyself under the mighty hand of thy God, and thou shalt behold and see the purpose of this day being fulfilled, even in thy life from this very day forth. Gird up the loins of thy mind. Let the Lord sanctify thy words and thy thoughts. And the hungry shall know, and they shall receive of thy God. And they shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord.
Amen. Yes.
Joy and be exceedingly glad.
Oh, amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God forever.
We have 30 minutes yet before lunch will be ready. And I looked around over the congregation. I thought, well, I haven't appointed anybody as yet. So I'm going to do some appointment. I'm going to take a little authority. Is that all right?
It's good.
Dorothy, how's it going to be?
She's gotten very well.
Good. Well, I'll tell you what we do. Good. We're going to let Dorothy preach for us. I'm going to take an offering for not only the expense of the church. There'll be a certain amount taken out for the expense of the church, and the rest of it will go to Paul. I told him I'd get him enough to get him a coat between here and Tennessee. Amen. And I don't want to. You folks to think that I'm going to neglect him, because he told me when I left Tennessee I had a handful of 20. He told my wife, I'll correct that, I had a handful of $20 bills and I don't have a one, you know. So we want to help him, and we want to help Bobby and Charlotte. So you give us as the Lord directs you. Dorothy, yeah, you can come on. You got a text?
I'll make it as long as it takes to take the offering, so hurry up. I'd like to confirm what Jean said. I told Ruth last night, I said, you know, we have got the most beautiful people in this congregation. You just look at everybody. They're beautiful. God is making us beautiful. Yes, God. He's transforming us. He's changing us. He's bringing forth life.
Yes.
Immortality to light.
Yes.
I mean, that's what's happening, right? Yes. Immortality is coming to light.
Yes.
The gospel. Praise the Lord.
Glory.
Hallelujah. When we love him and allow him to work in us, and yield to him, he doesn't work in us so quickly. And he's got a yielded charm. they're yielded to him. Praise God. Hundredfold coming forth. Hallelujah. And I just like to say that I just appreciate every one of you. Love every one of you. Wish we could all be together all the time. But we are in spirit. And, you know, just like in the natural, the blood is what ties people together in the natural. But by his spirit, we're joined. And that power is greater than the blood. That power can't be broken, because the natural, we can't break that power. Once he joins us by the spirit, it's his spirit, his life. And no matter what we do, it isn't broken. It can't be broken. And he's bringing us to a place where we don't want to break. Praise God. Are you done yet?